down a dangerous road. I have come to where I'm standing with a heavy heart and my hat clutched in my hand. Such a foolish man. God ain't known no greater sinner. I have come in search of Jesus, hoping he will understand. If I give my soul, will he clean these clothes I'm wearing? If I give my soul, will he put new boots on my feet? If I bow my head and beg God for his forgiveness, will he breathe new life within me and bring her back to me?
Hello, my name is Jeremiah Childers. I'm the Minister of Education and Senior Adults here at Inman First Baptist Church, and I am so glad that you're with us for a new study. We recently completed a four-week study on the parables, and today we begin a study on forgiveness. Over the last years, at least 10, in ministry, full-time ministry, the biggest conversation I've had with people in Bible study, Sunday school, marital classes, parenting classes, grief counseling, and grief support groups is over the issue of forgiveness. It is what we struggle, I think, most with. And yet, it is part of who we are as followers of Jesus that we are called not only to be forgiven, but to forgive. I want you to think for a moment in your life, where do you struggle with this concept of forgiveness? Where do you struggle with being forgiven? Where do you struggle to forgive? As we talk over the next weeks, we will look at stories from the Old Testament and the New Testament about forgiveness. We will ask ourselves, where do we see ourselves within those stories? And how do they shape and form us to be the people God would have us to be? We will listen carefully to the words of Jesus as he talks about forgiveness and as he tells his disciples to forgive. Not a question, not a suggestion, but an imperative. You must forgive. And as we talk about these over the next weeks and think about what it means for us in our spiritual formation to be more like Jesus in our lives, we must ask the question, if we are made in God's image, and God is a God of forgiveness, then for us to live in the ideal image to which God has created us, the image to which we bear God's image, then we must learn to be like God, forgiving others as we have been forgiven. What is forgiveness? What does it mean for me? And how do I live it out and embody it in my life? So as we come today, I would like to introduce this subject through the words of Jesus. Recently, we did the parable study, so today I will open up our conversation about forgiveness with a parable from Jesus. If you've got your Bible, you can turn to Matthew chapter 18. We'll be looking at verses 21 and following. Then Peter came and said to him, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" And Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. And when he began the reckoning, one who was owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay his lord, ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and the payment be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave his debt. But the same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves, who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, 'Pay me what you owe.' Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you.' But he refused. And then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. And when his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed. And they went and reported to the Lord all that had taken place. Then his Lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all the debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave, as I have had mercy on you?" And in anger, his Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or your sister from your heart. Jesus tells a parable in response to Peter's question. Lord, if someone in our company, in the body, in the church, does something to me, how many times do I have to forgive them? And he gives a very religious and pious answer. 7 times? Now, 7 times was in Jesus' day for many Pharisees and Jews, 7 was a generous offer. 7 times showed that you were religious. You were willing to go above and beyond and forgive somebody 7 times. And Jesus says, no, not 7. How about 77? And Jesus tells this little parable. A parable about a king who has someone that owes a great sum. And when he pleads with him, he forgives him and lets him go. The debt's been wiped. And that same person does not see what has happened to him should shape and form him to view the world differently. And yet he goes to someone who owes him, in comparison, a very small amount, and treats him harshly. No concept of what has happened to him should impact and form him to live differently and to view others differently. Well, he goes and treats his fellow slave badly. And upon hearing that, the king calls him back and says, "Look what you have done. Now I will treat you harshly." One of the things we'll talk about over the weeks is how that we are to model forgiveness. As God forgives us, we model it in our lives. We take it into ourselves, and it shapes and forms us to be like Christ, to be like God in the world, to be image bearers of God. So today, as we begin this series of forgiveness, what I'd like to do is open us in prayer, and then we will begin looking at least one story today from the Old Testament about forgiveness. I hope that it will inform you, but also help be transformative for you. During this time of social distancing, many of us are at home or not out and about. And for many of us, we don't encounter the people that, when we see them, brings up emotion, pain, hurt. It's often the people we love the most that hurt us the most. So during this time of social distancing, I hope that you'll take more time to reflect on where you need to be forgiven and where you need to forgive. I hope that you'll ask those 3 questions over these next weeks. God, what would you have me to know about forgiveness? In knowing about forgiveness, who are you calling me to be? And in being that person, God, what would you have me to do? This is not an easy subject, because each of us, when we think about forgiveness, think about all the things that we have done. We have done to others, the wounds we've inflicted. And we also think about those things that have happened to us. So I call us today to enter into prayer. Would you pray with me? God, as we come to a new opportunity for study and reflection around your word, God, let us hear the voice of Jesus. Let us hear his call not only to receive forgiveness, but to offer it as well. Over the next couple of weeks, as we talk about stories from the Old Testament and New Testament, Lord, we hope that you will transform us through the reading and meditation of your word. But God, help us, because this issue is about relationships. Relationship with you, relationship with ourselves, and relationship with others. And God, you have come into our lives to redeem and reconcile. But part of that is through forgiveness. God, help us to look at others in our lives, not through our wounds and our pains, but through the eyes of Christ. May your Holy Spirit guide us and lead us over these next weeks. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Quick overview of today's session. We'll begin with the questions around why is forgiveness so hard? Then we'll ask some questions about why you, why I, why we struggle to forgive. And then we'll listen to our first story of forgiveness, Joseph and his brothers, and we'll end with some closing words. So why is forgiveness so hard? The first reason is forgiveness is hard is because it's personal. Our relationships mean and have value to our lives. And the people we love the most are often the people that hurt us the most. And because it is so personal, it creates within us wounds, deep wounds. Because the people who are supposed to love us the most are often the people that hurt us the most. And many times the people that love us don't hurt us intentionally. Sometimes they don't even know they are hurting us. Sometimes they think they are loving us. And sometimes we look for things in other people to make us feel loved, and they are not able to do it, and that hurts us, and we don't know how to forgive. But then there are times in our lives where people we love truly do wound us, and sometimes on purpose or out of selfish reasons. And it hurts, and it wounds us. Many of us have had the experience of driving and being cut off in traffic, or having something incidental happen to the day where somebody has really made us mad. They've made us angry. But you know what? Most of us, by the end of the day, don't lie in bed awake thinking about it. But the people that love us the most, a simple word can cut hard and keep us up at night. And that's why sometimes when our relationships are broken, because it is so personal, it is really hard to heal. We have a hard time forgetting. Sometimes we think we've got to the point where we can forgive that person. Then it all, the memory of whatever the incident, comes and washes over us, and we re-experience it. It traumatizes us again. It opens up those wounds. And sometimes we cannot or we will not let go of the pain of whatever it is. And for some people the pain becomes a companion. And the companion of pain is one that gets them up in the day and is with them so much that the thought of letting it go, letting go of the bitterness, the anger, it's too hard. They will not let it go. It becomes their new normal. And sometimes we put so much conditions on forgiveness that the other person cannot ever fulfill them. And sometimes forgiveness isn't really what we want. We don't want to give it and we don't want to receive it. What we really want is to seek retribution, not reconciliation. We want to give that person back what they gave us. So forgiving people is a struggle. Where do we struggle to be forgiven? want you to think about, how do you perceive your actions and your identity? How has what you've done changed how you view yourself? How does it change the way that you view yourself in your eyes, in the eyes of others, and in the eyes of God? And for many people, the question is, am I worth forgiving? From what I've done, am I worth forgiving? Am I worth, as we'll talk about over the next weeks, am I worth resurrection in my life, in my relationship? Am I worthy of having someone come and bring me back to life? And do I deserve it? We struggle with that, don't we? When someone offers us grace and love without conditions, we struggle with that. We struggle with deserving forgiveness. And then we ask the question, are we defined by our transgressions? You know, I did that one thing, that one time. It was outside of my character of who I was. Am I that person? Am I that label that people and myself had put on me? Where do I find my identity? Then we have to ask the question, are we truly repentant and desiring a new start in the relationship? In relationship with God? In relationship with the other? And even the relationship with ourselves? These relationships, sometimes we don't oftentimes separate. But we have to ask ourselves in each of these incidences, how are we truly repentant and desiring a new start, not only with God, not only with that other person, even if it's a different kind of relationship, even if it's no relationship? But then how do we look at ourselves? How are we going to relate to ourselves now that we have been forgiven? Are we going to define ourselves by that thing anymore? Or we'll define ourselves by the grace and the mercy and the love to which we've received. I want you to think about today, where are you struggling to forgive or to be forgiven? I want you to think about if there's an incident that you're struggling to forgive. It could have been in your childhood. It could have been in your marriage. It could have been in friendship. It could have been at work. It could have been at church. But ask the question, what has this person done to me? And how do I see this other person or persons now? How did I view them before whatever the incident was, the breakdown in the relationship? And how do I view them now? What's the difference? Ask yourself, do I see them as a problem? You know, oftentimes in counseling sessions, the question becomes, do you see this person or as a problem? And if you see them as a problem, how do you deal with problems? Oftentimes we either get rid of a problem, which sometimes try to solve it, but a lot of times we avoid it. And people that we've had a broken relationship, oftentimes as a problem, we avoid them, we discard them, we do not seek them out anymore. And as followers of Jesus, we have to ask ourselves, no matter what somebody has done, when we look at them as a problem, how's that shaping and forming our understanding, not only of them, ourselves, and of God? And then sometimes we look at people that have hurt us, and you've said it, and I've said it, and other people have said it, they're dead to me. This person no longer exists in my life and in my heart. It is as though they are dead. Now, some people use that phrase, they're dead to me, a little cavalier. But a lot of people live it out. So not only are they a problem, now they're no longer really alive in your eyes. And then some of us have heard the expression, well, they've made my list. We put them on the enemy list. These are the people that if we had a list of people we do not love, we hate, these are the people that we could do without in our lives. And many of us at some point have had that list. Sometimes it is with friends that have hurt us. Maybe it is with family that we feel have betrayed the interest of the larger group. Whatever it is, you've got the list. These maybe aren't appropriate ways of looking at people that have hurt us. These are natural ways sometimes to feel. And sometimes our culture embraces these ways. You know, it is very easy nowadays just to delete somebody off of social media and almost avoid the problem. You've essentially removed them from your list, the list of good people, where you block people. There are all sorts of ways that we ignore other people and we stop seeing them as people. And as we struggle with forgiveness, whether it's with what we've done or someone else has done to us, we have to ask the question, how has this other person, what they've done to me, if I need to forgive somebody else, how has what they've done changed who I am? Am I a person that is different now? For some of us, it might be we're no longer naive. I was just naive in that relationship. That person, I thought they were one way, and the action showed me another. Sometimes it creates other things within us. Sometimes actions lead us down other roads. Someone has hurt us, and now we hurt others. Sometimes it is we seek consolation during this period with things that aren't healthy, addictions. So oftentimes, a person's sin or resistance to being a part of our lives in a positive way leads us to our own sin, our own resistance to being who God's called us to be. So how do I relate to myself differently? How do I relate to others? How do I relate to God differently? If I am changed because of what has happened in my life, I'm relating differently to others. My relationships have not only changed with that person, but oftentimes with others, with myself and with God. We have to ask the question, are we ready to let go? Can we let go of the anger and the pain? You know, if it is the thing that is our new identity, if it is a new companion, are we willing to let go of it? And can I move away from seeing this person as a problem and begin to see them as valuable? Part of letting go of the pain frees us, as we'll talk about in weeks to come, as Jesus will talk about forgiveness. It frees us from carrying around a weight that is too heavy for most of us to carry. But it also allows us to see someone through the eyes of God as no longer a problem or something that is dead or someone that is dead, but now we will see them as valuable. Now the value may be different than what it once was. The relationship will be different if there is a relationship, but we can at least look at that person and find some value in them. And by doing so, we raise them back to new life in our eyes and in our heart. And it allows us to form a new relationship with ourselves, with God, and even oftentimes with that other person.
Today we will be looking at Genesis 37. As we read today and look at the story of forgiveness of Joseph and his brothers, I will add some commentary as we go. There is a lot of background to Genesis so far that many of you may be familiar with and may not. I would love for you to go back and to read the story beginning with Abraham on. And as you read the stories in Genesis, notice how these families God chooses to be the people of God in the world. Much like our own families. They're broken. They hurt one another. They disappoint one another, and oftentimes God. And yet God continues to use them and redeems them and continually to show these stories to us because they are our stories. We are much like these people with whom we feel so far removed. And yet these stories are stories that have shaped Israel, and they shape Jesus. And they have the power to shape and form us as well. So today we begin in chapter 37 of Genesis with the story of Jacob and his sons. As you listen to this story today, imagine that you are one of the characters. Maybe you're Joseph. Maybe you're Jacob. Maybe you're one of the other brothers. How do you fit within this story? How do these relationships model for you your relationships with others? Maybe between parent and child. Maybe between siblings. Many times the most hurt we'll ever be is our family of origin. The way our parents love us or don't love us. The way our brothers or sisters love us or don't love us. The way we view ourselves based on the way others are viewed, or at least we perceive they're viewed by the people we want affection from. Oftentimes these are the ways that we are hurt the most. So it comes as no surprise that Genesis is a story of brokenness and redemption, of hurt and forgiveness. It is the story that gets played over and over again in Israel's life and in our lives, and is a story that is formative as we read it. So I hope that as we go through the story of Joseph today and his brothers, that you will see part of your story played out. So today, listen now as we begin the story in chapter 37. And as we move through Genesis, we'll hit certain portions of it, but not all of it. So I encourage you to pause from time to time, familiarize yourself with the passages, with the book in its context. And allow these stories of dysfunctional families to be a reminder that we live in dysfunctional families. We live in a world there where we resist God's will for our lives and the image to which God has created us, not just individually, but in our context of life, our families. And oftentimes it is in our families where we need to begin to forgive and be forgiven. So listen out to the story. Jacob settled in the land where his father had lived as an alien, the land of Canaan. And this is the story of the family of Jacob. And Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding flock with his brothers. And he was a helper to the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to their father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any other of his children because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a long robe with sleeves. But when his brothers saw their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him. And they could not speak peaceably to him. So we begin the story of Joseph with several awarenesses. One, Jacob loved Rachel. He loved Rachel more than he loved Leah, and Leah had more sons than Rachel. I wonder how oftentimes we love people because they remind us of other people. When Jacob looked at Joseph, how much he must have looked like Rachel. So his affection was given to Joseph, not necessarily for Joseph as his character, but what he reminded him of. And he dotes on his son. He makes him a long robe with long sleeves. And not only that, Joseph, at 17 years old, the age where he should be a man, acts like a child. He tattletales on his brothers, bringing a bad report to his father. So as we read the story, we have to be reminded that this is a long-stemming issue, a stemming issue within the family unit that Jacob has. Over time, the more these brothers see how much Jacob loves Joseph, the more contempt they have for him. The more that Joseph feels entitled to his father's love and affection and uses it as what? Power over his what? Brothers. It would be very easy for us to read these stories and think of Joseph as, well, simply a bystander, simply the person that is hurt but has no part in the story. He's not an innocent. And once Joseph, in verse 5, had a dream, and he told his brothers, they hated him even more. And he said to them, "Listen to this dream that I dreamed. There were binding sheaves in the field. Suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright, and then your sheaves gathered around it and bowed down to my sheaf." And his brothers said to him, "Are you indeed to reign over us? Are you indeed to have dominion over us?" So they hated him even more because of his dreams and his words. Now, we will find out as we continue to read the story that the dream that Joseph has is true. It turns out to be true. It is an inspired dream. And yet he tells it to them. I mean, Joseph just does not seem to have any kind of sense that his relationship with his father and his sense of entitlement is problematic within the relationship. He does not seem to have any empathy of how he is viewed in his father's eyes versus his brothers, and somehow continues to use that, and as he does so, it pushes his brothers away. Now what happens to Joseph is unconscionable. He does not deserve it. But it would be too easy for us just to villainize these brothers, but imagine living in a family system where you do not feel loved. And the one that seems to be the prized son is the one who continues to grow in power over you to the point he thinks he will have dominion. Then he had another dream in verse 9 and told it to his brothers. "Look, I've had another dream. The sun, the moon, the 11 stars were bowing down to me." But when he told it to his father and to his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, "What kind of dream is this that you had? Shall we indeed come, and I and your mother and your brothers, and bow the ground before you?" So his brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. Jacob, in many ways, comes to his senses and realizes maybe he's created a little monster. What kind of dream is this? Joseph doesn't have a filter, and although the dream is true and comes to be true, it doesn't help in the way that he tells it. In the way that, in many ways, he flaunts his identity of being the beloved of his father over others. So it comes as no surprise that over time, this animosity between these brothers builds. And like many of us, as we have strained relationships, we begin to imagine all the things we'd like to do. Sin has a way of getting inside of us and shaping us and forming us to think of things before we ever do them. How we will harm those that have harmed us. How we will pay back those who have given bad to us. And very rarely do many of us take those into complete action. But if you're like me and you sit with your wife and watch Dateline from time to time, you know that many of the schemes that people have in life begin with thoughts and conversations. And over time, those conversations build up to a point where they lead to action. The reverse of what we prayed over these last weeks in Bible study and as a church, "God, what would you have me to know? Who would you have me to be? What would you have me to do?" is true as we entertain the resistance to God in our life, sin. As we think about those things that we would like to do to others, whether good or bad, we begin to think of them as a narrative in our heart and our mind, and they build up till they shape and form us to be that which is not what God would have us to be, and leads us to do the things God would not have us to do. And as we read the story, we read a story about brothers who think and talk and then do. And as they do, a thing that harms and inflicts pain on their brother, it leads to brokenness. A brokenness of a relationship between themselves and their father and Joseph. But it also leads to more. It leads to lies. And it leads to hurt. So as we read this story, imagine in your life where you have been harmed or you have hurt another. When did it begin? Was your actions immediate or did you think on them first? Did you have conversation in yourself till it shaped you and formed you to do the thing that hurt the other? Now Joseph and his brothers. Now his brothers went to pasture their flocks near Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem? Come, I will send you to them." And he answered, "Here I am." So he said to them, "Go now, see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring word back to me." So he sent him from the valley of Hebron. And he came to Shechem, and a man found him wandering in the fields, and the man asked him, "What are you seeking?" "I am seeking my brothers," he said. "Tell me, please, where are they pasturing the flock?" And the man said, "They have gone away, for I heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. And they saw him from a distance, and before he came near to them, they conspired to kill him and throw him into one of the pits. And then we shall say a wild animal has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams. But when Reuben heard it, he delivered him out of their hands, saying, 'Let us not take his life.' Reuben said to them, 'Shed no blood. Throw him into his pit here in the wilderness, but lay no hand on him, that we might rescue him out of their hand and restore him to his father.' So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the long robe with sleeves that he wore. And they took him and threw him in a pit. And the pit was empty. There was no water in it. Then they sat down to eat. And looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead with their camels, carrying gum and balm and resin on their way to carry it down to Egypt. Then Judas said to his brothers, 'What profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, for he is our brother, our own flesh.' And his brothers agreed. And when some Midianite traders passed by, they drew Joseph up, lifting him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they took Joseph to Egypt. And when Reuben returned to the pit and saw Joseph was not in the pit, he tore his clothes. He returned to his brothers and said, 'The boy is gone, and where can I turn?' And they took Joseph's robe, slaughtered a goat, dipped the robe into blood. And they had the long robe with sleeves taken to their father, and they said, 'This we have found. See now whether it is your son's robe or not.' And he recognized it and said, 'It is my son's robe. A wild animal has devoured him. Joseph is without doubt torn to pieces.' And then Jacob tore his clothes and put sackcloth on his loins and mourned for his son for many days. And all his sons and all his daughters sought to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. 'No, I shall go down to Sheol to my son mourning.' And thus his father bewailed him. Meanwhile, the Midianites had sold him into Egypt to Potiphar, one of Pharaoh's officials. Joseph is sold into slavery. His brothers trick their father and tell him that he is dead. Joseph goes to Egypt, and in Potiphar's house, you remember the story, he works hard. He builds trust, and then Potiphar's wife, who lusts after him, tries to get him to do the unthinkable. Commit adultery against the man who has trusted him. He refuses. Yet she tricks her husband, and he ends up in jail. But even in his slavery and even in prison, God continues to work in his life, and over time, through the interpretation of dreams and through many adversities, Joseph finds himself second in control of Egypt. And there he interprets the dreams of Pharaoh, and when famine comes, he is able to deal with it in ways that are productive and benefit Egypt. But famine hits his family, and they must go to the place where there is grain. They must go to Egypt. So the brothers go. And when the brothers get there, Joseph recognizes them, although they do not recognize him. After waiting to reveal himself with his brothers, the climax of the story comes in Genesis 45. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him. And he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him, and he made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it, and the households of Pharaoh heard it. And Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him. So dismayed they were at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me." And they came closer. And he said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves, because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. And God sent me here before you to preserve you for a remnant on the earth, and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. And he has made me father to Pharaoh, and lord of all his house, and ruler over the land of Egypt. Hurry and go to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me and do not delay. And you shall settle in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks and your herds and all that you have. And I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to go. And you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father how greatly I am honored in Egypt and all that they have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here." They fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept. While Benjamin wept upon his neck, and he kissed all his brothers and wept upon him, and after his brothers talked with him. And when the report was heard in Pharaoh's house, "Joseph's brothers have come," Pharaoh and his servants were pleased. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Say to your brothers, 'Do this, load your animals and go back to the land of Canaan. Take your father and your households and come to me, and I will give you the best land of Egypt, and you may enjoy the fat of the land.'" And later on, they go out of Egypt and came to their father Jacob in the land of Canaan. And they told him, "Joseph is still alive. He is ruler over all of Egypt." Jacob, he was stunned. He could not believe that. But when they told him all the words Joseph had said to them, and when they saw the wagons that Joseph had sent to carry them, the spirit of the father of Jacob revived. Israel said, "Enough. My son Joseph is alive. I must go and see him before I die." As you continue to read in Genesis 46 and following, you'll see a father and son being reconciled together. A son that was dead is now alive, and Jacob comes and blesses him and his Joseph's sons. Over the course of the reading, you will find Jacob's last words. You will see his death and his burial. And the question becomes for the brothers, now that father is gone, even though Joseph has said that he has forgiven us, that this has been God's will the whole time, will he still keep his word? Many of us feel that way sometimes in our lives. We think people have said they have forgiven us, but we doubt it. We doubt it because if we were in their place, how would we react? Would we want to settle the score? Would we want retribution? Would we want to do what was done to us? So the brothers are nervous, and rightly so. They live in a world where not everyone models God. And sometimes forgiveness comes with what? Conditions. I'll forgive you if. I'll forgive you only because. And here they question Joseph's forgiveness. All the good that Joseph has done to them, they still question. Our father's out of the picture. What if Joseph decides to seek vengeance? Chapter 50, verse 15 of Genesis. Realizing their father was dead, Joseph's brother said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for the wrong that we did to him?" Sometimes guilt even festers within us, and that guilt of what we've done, even if we've been forgiven, even if someone has said to us, "We are reconciled," if we truly understand how hard it is to see ourselves in that position of forgiveness, then we can't imagine if we've done something so horrible that somebody could forgive us. And these brothers do not know if Joseph is honest. What if he, in this place of power, decides to pay us back? So they approach Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, 'I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father.'" So they go, and in their father's voice, double check with Joseph. "Are you sure you have forgiven us?" Then his brothers also wept, and they fell down before him and said, "We are your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do me harm, God intended it for good in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." And in this way he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. Now Joseph weeps, and as he weeps, he is consoling his brothers yet again. "I've forgiven you. Look, you've done this horrible thing, and something good has come out of it." Now in our lives, not everything that has been done to us, we would say, is God's will. Honestly, it's hard to even think that, at least for me. But it doesn't mean that the bad in our lives can't be redeemed for something good. For that is the power of resurrection that works over and over again in our lives. The story of Joseph, in many ways, is a template of the story of Jesus that we find later. A story of honesty about identity, of rejection, of being pushed away, even almost to death, of being reborn and having power and authority, but not using power and authority, but using it humbly, offering forgiveness and grace, inviting and welcoming those that have hurt back into the fold. The story of Joseph is a story that reminds me that we do oftentimes hear that word, am I in the place of God? As image bearers of God, we oftentimes are in a place where we can forgive, where we can model for people what it means to be God's people in the world, to model for them Jesus. Now, it's not easy. It's not easy to be asked to be put in that position. But as we'll hear over and over again over these weeks, it is for us to embody God in the world and embody forgiveness. It is easy to talk about God's forgiveness, but it is hard to live it out. And Joseph, of all people, had reason to hate his brothers, had reasons to want payback. Imagine yourself in his position, being sold into slavery, being a slave, being in prison, having plenty of time to imagine what he would do if he saw his brothers again. Many of you have had that experience. Many of you have, if you're honest, are like me and have thought about what you would say and what you would do to that person that hurt you, that abandoned you. It's not easy to forgive. And as we'll talk over the weeks to come, it's not easy sometimes to forgive, and forgiveness is not easy. Forgiveness is costly. Many of us, if we're honest, struggle with this more than anything else in the Christian journey. We've often told people, we forgive you, but we don't. We've often hurt people and wondered if they've truly forgiven us. Are their words true? Do they view us differently now after they said those words? Many of us struggle with this because it is personal. It is relational. But to model it means to embody for others God's love and grace and forgiveness. Joseph says, am I in the place of God? He was. He was in that he modeled for them what God was like. And if you are a follower of Jesus, you have embraced the image of God in your life. You are journeying towards Christ's likeness. And in that, you are embodying God's love and forgiveness to your family, and to your friends, to your work, and to your church. It is hard work. It does not come naturally or easily to forgive others. It is a practice that has to be done over and over again. And as we talk over the next weeks, I want you to imagine yourself as Joseph. Could you have forgiven your brothers? Would you forgive your brothers? Where do you need to forgive your siblings, your parent, your spouse, your children, your friends, your church? How do we forgive those who hurt us intentionally? How do we forgive those that hurt us over and over again? How do we forgive those who never repent and ask for forgiveness? These are hard questions. These are intimate questions. These are personal questions. And each of you, if you are honest, are struggling or have struggled with these questions. And although I may not be able to give you a complete and final answer, the Holy Spirit, through the reading and the reflection of God's Word, the stories of the Old Testament and the New Testament, the teachings of Jesus, and the power to transform you to embody that question, am I in the place of God? We are never in the place of God for judgment, but we can be in the place of God for forgiveness, modeling for others what God's love looks like in the flesh. So as we continue over the next weeks, I hope that you will reflect deeply, prayerfully, where you need to grow. Where you need to forgive, where you need to reconcile. If you need to talk to somebody, you'll find my contact information below. Feel free to contact me. I'll be happy to pray with you and talk with you. I want you to understand that this journey of forgiveness is not one that you have to do alone, but it is one that you must do. As we've talked about, Jesus does not ask us or suggest to us to forgive, but commands us to forgive. But as we talk over the next weeks, our understanding is we cannot accept forgiveness for all that we do, for all that we resist God's image in our lives, if we're not willing to forgive others. So I end today with this question, one that I hope that you will reflect on. Where are you struggling to forgive or be forgiven? Let us end with prayer. God, we thank you for today, for the story of Joseph and his brothers that remind us that forgiveness starts in the place that we find ourselves first, our families. God, sometimes forgiveness is hard because the people that are closest to us are the ones that wound us the most. Sometimes it is because of dysfunction. Dysfunction we know about and sometimes we don't know about, that creates strains in relationships that push us to places that we would never, ever think we would ever go. But God, as Jesus teaches us in the Sermon on the Mount, something like murder just doesn't begin with the action, but begins with hate and malice. So help us to discover deep within ourselves areas of resistance to your love and grace, and the love and grace you called us to share with those closest to us and those we just have met. God, give us strength for this journey, a journey where forgiveness becomes a daily practice. Daily practice because daily you are forgiving us. Help us, Lord, to see in our lives areas where we need to grow. And in growing, may we live out in action, embodying for others the forgiveness you have shown us, that it will be a reflection of your kingdom to them, They may come to know your forgiveness as well. God, be with everybody who can't be together in person through social distancing. But bring us together through the power of your Spirit that we may be one. One body and one family. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.